Hello everyone and welcome to our sixth webinar of the BioExcel Educational Series. Today we have Karsten Kutzner who is going to talk about optimizing cluster and simulation setup with GROMACS. I'm Rosen Apostolov and I'll be the host today. Before we start with the main webinar, I would like to give a very short introduction about today's webinar. First, you have to know that this webinar is being recorded and the recording of the webinar will be posted on the BioExcel's YouTube channel and also on the website so that you can look at it later at your convenience. At the end of the webinar, we will have questions and answers session where I will let you ask your questions to Karsten. If your audio doesn't work, I will read the questions on your behalf. You can use the questions panel within the GoToWebinar application to write your questions while we have the presentation. Today's webinar is organized by BioExcel, which is a center of excellence for computational biomolecular research. Our center works with several important codes for molecular modeling and simulations, GROMACS that you know, Hadoop for integrative modeling and CPMD, which is used for hybrid QMMM simulations. We work on improving their performance, efficiency, and scalability. We also work with several very popular key workflows and platforms such as Galaxy, KNIME, Apache Taverna to help users with automation and improve their productivity. Our center also is promoting best practices and is offering a lot of training events to users. What might be of big interest to you is that we have launched several interest groups in different areas of molecular research that offer more guided advice to users. What might be of biggest interest to you is best practices for performance tuning interest group. You can find more about it on our website, and we also provide several support platforms such as forums, a chat channel, and the video channel where we have recordings of our webinars. And today is my big pleasure to present you Karsten Kutzner, who is a senior scientist at the University of Göttingen. During his PhD, he was doing numerical simulations of Earth's magnetic field. Later, he continued with high performance and parallel computing. Since 2004, he's working at the Max Planck Institute for Biophysical Chemistry in the group of Helmut Grubmüller. And his interests are in the area of metal development, high performance computing, and atomistic biomolecular simulations. So now I will let Karsten continue with his talk. Welcome, Karsten.
Hello, Rosen. Hi, Rosen. Thanks for the introduction. So let's see, should be on play already.
Yes.
Is that correct like that?
I think you need to select the play button. We see the visual screen.
Ah.
Yes.
So how about now?
Yes, it's good.
Okay. 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 Yo. So the title of my talk is Optimizing Cluster and Simulation Setup for GROMACS. And a small word of warning here. So I'm not talking about simulation setup, but about really setting up a compute cluster for GROMACS simulation. So as I assume that you have some familiarity with the GROMACS software and that you have already set up simulations and you know how to produce a TPR file and run things. So this is more about tuning settings for optimal or for minimal runtime. So I would also like to recommend the excellent webinar number 2 in this series by Mark Abraham, which also covers performance tuning and GROMACS optimizations. And there you will also see a detailed introduction into building and running GROMACS. There, I'm not going so much into the details here, but there is also a bit of overlap between these two talks. So here I'm going to focus on more on the hardware side and on actual benchmarks. So the basic question that I want to address here is how to produce as much MD trajectory as possible for your science. How can that be achieved? So depending on whether you have access to compute resources or whether you want to buy a cluster, we can rephrase the question quite a bit. So in one case, you will be limited by the number of core hours that you have allocated on a supercomputer, for example. And in the other case, you will be limited by the amount of money that you have. So we will try to answer these two questions here. So the question one is, how can actually optimal performance be obtained on a given cluster? And the second part of the talk is about what actually is the optimal hardware to run GROMACS on if you start from building your own cluster. Okay, let's start with question one. How can optimal GROMACS performance be obtained? So already before the simulation, you lay the foundation of good performance, for example, by choosing a recent compiler, by choosing the most recent SIMD instructions that your CPU supports, by choosing a good MPI library. But also, when you set up your system, you can already do a lot by choosing, for example, virtual sites, which will give you which will enable a far longer time step compared to the usual settings. So and when actually launching the MD run application, the main benefits come from optimizing the parallel run settings. So you will want to make sure that you have that you reach a balanced computational load between the resources that you have, and you will want to make sure that you keep any communication overhead small. To better understand what these, so we have several settings that we can change when we start GROMACS, and to better understand what these things do and what we can do as users to speed up the computation, I want to recap what happens in a GROMACS time step. So we want to look at the GROMACS parallel time step, but we start with a serial time step first. So on the left hand, you see a sketch of what happens during a time step, and we just look at the colored things right now, at the blue and the orange stuff. So most of the time, GROMACS calculates Coulomb and van der Waals interactions. And usually with periodic boundary conditions, we use the particle mesh Ewald method, and PME decomposes these interactions into short-range and long-range contributions. So the short-range part, which is blue here, can be efficiently calculated in real space, and at the same time and independently, the long-range part can be efficiently calculated in reciprocal space. And for the reciprocal space, you need the Fourier transformation of the charge density. And this is where typically the problems begin, because in parallel to do Fourier transformation, this is quite communication intense. We'll come back to that later. A nice feature of PME, though, is that it allows to shift work between these two parts. You can shift work at the same numerical accuracy or comparable accuracy between the real and the reciprocal space, simply by what you see on the left hand and on the bottom. If you make the cutoff larger and at the same time the grid a little bit coarser, then if you scale that by the same factor, you reach the same numerical accuracy as when you have a small cutoff and a very fine grid. This will come in quite handy when we use GPUs. So in this slide here, we see a parallel time step. So GROMACS uses a combination of MPI and OpenMP to parallelize the system on the available processors. And here we see an example with three MPI ranks. And within each MPI ranks, there's a group of, here in this example, four OpenMP threads that act on the data of that rank. And it depends on whether we look at the direct space or at the reciprocal space contributions, how the work is actually distributed on the ranks. So for the direct space part, GROMACS uses domain decomposition. That simply means that your MD system is chopped up into X by Y by Z domains, and each of these domains is then assigned to an MPI rank, which calculates all the interactions of that rank. In the reciprocal space part, GROMACS usually uses either slabs or stencils, and each of these slabs or stencils is then assigned to an MPI rank. Obviously, there's some boundary volume that needs to be communicated so that all the interactions can be calculated. For the direct space interactions, that is not so much a problem. So this is simply a small layer of atoms at the boundary of the domains, and this at least the size of these boundary layers that doesn't directly depend on how many of these domains you have. However, in the reciprocal space part, at some point you need to do a transpose of the grid from, let's say, vertical to horizontal layout, and in that process, if you have R ranks, then R squared messages are involved. So while the PME calculation is known to scale with order n log n, if n is the number of atoms, usually in parallel the communication is the bottleneck. In the lower left plot, we see an example for a small benchmark system, 80,000 atoms, distributed on more and more cores. This is the x-axis, and I plotted simply the time spent in MPI routines in blue during the whole benchmark. So this gets more and more if we go to a larger number of cores, and this is mainly due to the time spent in the MPI all-to-all routine. So this is the green triangles here, So this MPI all-to-all routine is used exclusively during the FFT grid transpose in GROMACS. So to alleviate this problem a bit of these R squared messages during the FFT, GROMACS can offload the long range part of the electrostatics to a subset of the MPI ranks, which is then typically on another set of nodes. So usually you need about a quarter of all nodes to calculate the long range part of PME, and this then reduces the number of messages to be sent by a factor of 16. So this is done by sending the charges and the positions of the charges over to a set of PME processors here on the right hand side in orange. They do PME, and at the end, near at the end of the time step, the long range part of the forces is transferred back to the other set, to the particle direct space processors, which then add this contribution to the calculated short-range forces. Okay, what you can also do, if you have GPUs on your system, then you can, with GROMACS, offload the short-range non-bonded forces to GPUs, and this works similar to what we just seen in the last slide. So while the CPUs are doing PME and also integration, things like that, updates, the GPUs calculate the short-range non-bonded forces. So in order that this works well, there are three load balancing level mechanisms implemented in GROMACS. So what you need to do if you have different sets of computations on different sets of hardware, you somehow need to balance the work. And in the upper part here, we see the number of particle-particle or the number of short-range processors, MPI ranks, needs to be balanced to the with respect to the number of PME processors. In the middle, we see you need somehow to find the optimum between cutoff and grid spacing. And in the bottom, you see that there is a load balancing mechanism that balances any uneven work between the direct space domains. So the first mechanism, the number of PME nodes, this is assigned statically at the beginning of the simulation. GROMACS does that for you. The second load balancing mechanism is done. It's also evaluated at the beginning of the simulation. However, then it stays fixed for the rest of the simulation. And the dynamic load balancing, that's also why it's called dynamic. So it's throughout the whole simulation, it continuously adapts to any uneven load between the domains. So the good news is that these automatic load balancing mechanisms, they work so well that if you have single nodes with one CPU and optionally one GPU, then in most of the cases, the GROMACS automatic settings give you optimal performance if you use thread MPI. So here I could already end this webinar. If you have just nodes like this, a single CPU and a single GPU, then in principle you don't need to hand tune anything. However, today's nodes are usually more complex. You have either multi-socket CPU nodes, or you have you can have one or more GPUs attached to them, and you could also even have a cluster of these nodes. So in these cases, manual tuning will quite drastically enhance the performance that you get. In the next part, I will talk about what you can do. Tips and tricks for performance tuning in GROMACS. Yeah, the most important tip I found out for myself, and I often talk to others, if you're in doubt whether you get a good performance or not, make a benchmark. A benchmark just takes a few minutes. You can test different settings easily, and you will directly see from the results which of these settings are better and which are not so good. So these are my pet benchmarks that we see here. So I often use these. The left one is a typical MD system, I would say. So it's about 80,000 atoms large. It's a membrane channel embedded in a lipid membrane surrounded by water and ions. And the right system is a larger MD system. So this is a ribosome in water. This is 2 million atoms large. This is a nice test system if you want to scale out to larger machines, for example. Okay, let's start with the tips and tricks. So the first tip I would have is actually about how to get useful performance numbers from benchmarks in GROMACS. So these automatic load balancing mechanisms that we talked about, so the dynamic load balancing between the direct space domains and the load balancing between Coulomb cutoff and PME grid spacing, they need some time to reach the optimum. And that's why it's important to throw away these first time steps from the timing measurements. So there's switches to MD run for that. So for example, reset step or reset halfway, and there you can simply exclude these first time step where the load is not balanced from the benchmark measurements. So on the right hand side, we see this is an example. the time it takes for a time step with respect to the first time step, and we see that for various settings this goes down with a time step number, and here it takes about 200 time steps, but to reach some kind of equilibrium. However, this can take quite long. This on a large parallel machine, this could take 2,000 or even more time steps. So there, it's a good idea to look at the md.log output file, and there we will see lines like, for example, the first line here in the black box, DD step 39, load imbalance force 14.8%. That tells us that there is still a load imbalance in the force calculation between these domains. And if we look at the bottom of the page here, so at step 5,000 or 10,000, this imbalance goes down to about 1%, which is pretty much what you can reach. So there you have a balanced force computation between the domains. And in between, we see lots of lines, step 80, timed with PME grid, Coulomb cutoff something. There you see that GROMACS adjusts the PME grid and the Coulomb cutoff size for you, and at some point it will tell you, okay, I found the optimal PME grid, this is 96 times something, Coulomb cutoff this. So that's the point where you should reset the counters. A second thing to do if you have CPU only nodes, you can optimize the ratio of the or the amount of the PME, the number of the PME nodes. So GROMACS will estimate for you how many PME nodes it needs. For example, if you run on 16 nodes, or if you have 16 MTI processes, it will choose 4 for the long range part of PME. This is based on cutoff and grid settings. However, GROMACS cannot know your network, so whether you run on Ethernet or InfiniBand and how big the latency is. And this is where the Tune PME tool comes into play. This takes the estimate which GROMACS computes for you from cutoff and grid settings and tries out settings around this value. And usually, if you have more than 8 MPI ranks, separate PME nodes will perform better. And here on the right-hand side, we see how much you can typically improve up on the automatic settings when running the Tune PME tool. So we see that you get another 10 to 30% performance by choosing to tune the number of PME nodes. Another thing to consider is the optimal mix of thread and ranks, especially if you have GPU nodes. So due to this heterogeneous parallelization based on MPI and OpenMP, work can be distributed in various ways. So if you use pure OpenMP, this usually performs well on single nodes, but this does not scale so well across CPU sockets. So this is the blue line in this right graph here. There we see this is a two-socket 16-core node, and we see that OpenMP for this benchmark performs best as long as we stay on 8 or less cores. However, if we go to more cores, then a pure MPI parallelization is faster. So on multi-socket nodes, usually pure MPI is best. You could also choose a combination of MPI and OpenMP. However, this often adds additional overhead. So at least in this case here on CPU nodes, it's slower than either OpenMP or MPI. However, if you have GPUs attached to your CPUs, then it's slightly different, because for GPUs it's beneficial to have few large domains that offload their data to the GPU. So generally on single socket nodes, it's beneficial to use pure OpenMP. However, if you have multi-socket CPU nodes with one or many GPUs, it's not so clear. There it pays off to find the optimum. That's what I did here for the two benchmark systems. So we see the performance of the benchmark system on the Y scale, and on the X scale we see different combinations of threads and ranks. So this is a two-socket CPU node with 2 × 10 cores, so altogether 40 hyperthreads, and I used either 40 MPI ranks with one thread or 20 MPI ranks each with two threads and so on. And we see in the lowermost black lines that what I just mentioned on CPU nodes, the pure MPI is fastest. So if we add OpenMP threads, then the performance goes slightly down to the right. However, if we add 1, 2, 3, or 4 GPUs, that's the blue, green, red, or light blue lines, then there's an optimum somewhere in the middle at several threads per rank. So you're often at, let's say, about 4 to 5 threads per rank. And this can be 30% more than the standard settings that GROMACS would choose for you. So this really pays off to look for that optimum. Here's an example of a cluster of such nodes. So again, two-socket nodes with two GPUs on them, and the black lines show the benchmarks on the CPUs only, and the blue lines show the same with GPUs. And we again see that in the CPU case, we end up with either pure MPI or two OpenMP threads, and in the case of with GPUs, we have a couple of OpenMP threads per rank, so 2, 4, or 5 turns out to be optimal here. Hyperthreading, which is supported by modern Intel CPUs, is usually beneficial in the single node case. It almost always gives you 10 or 15% extra performance, so it's useful to use it, to have it switched on. If you scale out your system to many nodes, then this effect decreases with higher parallelization. So in this example, we see I've marked all the benchmarks that have had the highest performance with hyperthreading with a yellow circle, and you see that, well, about 16 nodes or so, hyperthreading is beneficial, and then later the fastest settings were found without hyperthreading. Generally, if you want to have a good parallel efficiency, it's good to have about 1,000 atoms or more per core. So, here we see parallel efficiency is about 71 or 73% at about 8 to 16 nodes. And then while you can scale to about 100 or even less atoms per core, and you will still see a performance benefit, however, at the cost of a reduced parallel efficiency. So basically, you're throwing away most of your cycles. So if you want to use separate PME nodes on GPU nodes, then if you do that in a naive way, then you would leave GPUs unused. So here's an example where you see four nodes, and if you would make the normal separation in particle-particle and PME nodes, then here we see that the PME node, the orange one, would leave the GPU unused, simply because PME cannot be executed on GPUs. Usually it's not a good idea to leave resources unused, so what you could do here is to assign, for example, half of the MPI ranks for PME with a command line we see on at the bottom here. So you would end up with the same number of ranks, both for PME and for both for the long range and for the short range part on each node. And on each node, you would be able to use the GPU because there's short range processes on each node. So this is a would be a better approach. And you could still balance the load between the PME and the PP processes. So here's an example where we have well, big nodes with two GPUs and 20 cores per node. So each core is a square here, and with you can choose with a command line switches NTOMP and NTOMP PME. You can separately choose how much resources to allocate it to the short range and to the long range part. So generally, even with these complex hardware setups, you can achieve optimal performance or optimal settings for GROMACS. So this slide shows the impact of the compiler. So while there's newer compilers around, I just want to make the point that the performance can be quite different depending on which compiler you choose. So we see here in orange, these are benchmarks on CPU nodes, and in these white blocks show the same nodes with GPUs added. And in the CPU case, we see that depending on whether you choose an early GCC or a later one or ICC, the performance can vary by up to 20%, 25%. So generally, GCCs from 4.7 on produce the fastest binaries with GROMACS. ICC compilers don't work as well on AMD hardware. However, when you look at the white entries here, so with GPUs, the effect is not as drastic. So the most pronounced effect here we see on CPU nodes. Another tip to improve the throughput of your simulations is to use multi-simulations. This is especially useful if you run on GPU nodes. So due to this offloading approach that the short-range bonded force, non-bonded forces are offloaded to the GPU, the GPU is idle during part of the time step, about during 15 or 40%. And if you now run several replicas of the same system, for example, with different starting velocities or so, on your GPU node, then the individual replicas can run slightly out of sync. And while one replica doesn't use the GPU, the GPU can be used by the other replicas. So in effect, you get a drastically enhanced aggregated performance. So if you obviously you get many, let's say here in this example, you get four trajectories which are a bit shorter. However, if you sum the trajectory length together, you will get a lot more than compared to running a single replica on this system. And the benefit not only comes from the using the idle time on the GPU, you get additional benefits due to higher efficiency at lower parallelization, because each replica will use yet less cores on the CPU, for example. Here's an example of what you can achieve with that. So we see the membrane benchmark again run on a node with two 10-core processors and two GTX 980 GPUs. So the lowest bar here, the light blue one, which has a performance of about 26.8 nanoseconds per day. This is without GPUs. The one above is with one 980 GPU. And this is the optimized settings. So this is already OpenMP threads and ranks have been manually optimized. But if you then run four replicas on the same node, you get an additional benefit of a factor of 1.4 to 1.5 on top of the already optimized settings. And the three bars on the top, the black, dark blue, and gray bar, show the same for the same node with two GPUs. So all even there, you get about the same benefits. So this really makes sense, and four replicas is not a lot. I mean, you see, you could use more. It's a good idea to use more than two replicas, but from four on, you already see most of the benefits you can get. The last tip I have here concerns MPI libraries. So this is when you run on larger compute clusters. I always found that usually there are several MPI libraries that you can use there, and typically they all perform different. And often there's one that really performs well, and there's others that have problems. And here we see that I compare Intel MPI and IBM MPI, and you see that you don't get as a good performance on many nodes with Intel MPI. This has here nothing to do with Intel MPI. It's more that on this special machine, there were the configuration of Intel MPI was simply not optimal. Well, you could spend lots of time as a user to find out to tune all these settings, or you could simply try out the other MPI libraries and this often saves you a lot of time. And here in this case, the IBM MPI library showed nice results. So sometimes it's not even in the code the problem, but in other codes in MPI libraries or settings or whatever. Well, to sum up the question one that we had, so there's several things that you can do to get higher performance. This is virtual sites, this is using multi-simulations, optimizing threads per rank on GPU nodes, using the tuning, PME tuning tool, using a recent compiler, or using hyperthreading. And on the right hand, I plotted the typical trajectory gain that you can expect. And you should keep in mind that in most cases, these gains are orthogonal. So if you use virtual site, this will give you a factor of two. Compiler can give you an extra 20%. Hyperthreading can give you an extra 10%, and so on. So this really pays off. Okay. Now let's come to question two. What is actually the optimal hardware to run GROMACS on? So you might ask, okay, optimal, what do you mean by optimal? So optimal might mean performance to price ratio, might mean the highest single node performance that you can get. Optimal might be for you the lowest time to solution or the lowest energy consumption. But there could also be simple requirements of rack space, so you just have a limited amount of space to put your cluster. So our goal was in this investigation, cost efficiency of simulations. So we wanted to maximize the trajectory that we get on a fixed budget. And what we did is we determined the prices and the performance for about 50 hardware configurations. We tested them with the two MD systems I showed you. And altogether, we tested about 12 CPU types and 13 GPU types in different combinations. And the performance that is reported in the following slides is always the optimized performance. So We always optimize the threads to ranks ratio, we optimize the number of PME nodes, and we used hyper-threading where beneficial. Maybe a quick word on the GPUs that we used in the test nodes. So this can be put into two categories. So the upper category here, which is red here, these are professional Tesla GPUs. So they have a high double precision throughput. They usually have a large memory. They have ECC memory. While the other GeForce GTX GPUs here on the green part of the table, they don't have ECC memory. They just have a good single precision throughput, no double precision throughput. And typically, at least it was the case that the memory was smaller, but that's not the case anymore. However, GROMACS runs in mixed precision mode typically, so it uses single precision only anyway on GPUs. I should also say that here we just, I mean, this investigation is already started about 2 years ago or so. Back then, we could only use NVIDIA GPUs, CUDA compatible GPUs, and now since GROMACS 5.1, it's also possible to use AMD GPUs via OpenCL. And keep that in mind. So these are also a good idea. So this is the result of our investigation. We see on the x-axis the simulation performance. So this is for the smaller benchmark system, and on the y-axis the total cost for the hardware. So we have several white circles here. These are CPU only nodes, and some of these are connected with a dotted line to blue or red circles, and the colored circles mean that we plugged in a GPU into exactly that same node. And if you now plug in a GPU into a CPU node, then the performance goes up and the price goes also up. So you follow these dotted lines to the right and a bit to the upper part of the plot. All the blue dots are nodes with consumer class GPUs. So by plugging in a consumer class GPU into a CPU only node, we typically see an increase in performance by a factor of 2 to 4. At the same time, if you plug in a professional Tesla GPU into a CPU node, for example, here where which we see here with the first red dot with the one in it, there we mainly move along lines of constant performance to price. So the performance goes up, but at the same time the price goes up. In general, it's always a good idea if you want to have a good performance to price ratio to put in a consumer class GPU to your node, while professional Tesla GPUs only give you a higher performance but don't change your performance to price ratio. So this is the same plot we just saw. This is a bit more complicated. Don't be scared by all those details. Let's just look at the right half of the plot. This is the membrane benchmark. On the left we see the ribosome benchmark. Again we see these gray lines. These are lines of constant performance to price. So we want to get to the lower right part of the plot. We want to have a high performance and a low hardware cost. And what I want to point out here is just if we look at these green nodes, so all these circles that have a white fill, these are CPU nodes. If we again move along these dotted lines to the right hand, we add one or many more GPUs, and in this case here of AMD, we see that if we add the first GPU, then we get a lot better in the performance. We get slightly higher in the hardware cost, but not so much. However, if we add more GPUs, a second GPU, there the effect is not as pronounced. And I should also point out here that the highest performance to price ratios we reach here with the Core i7-5820K, for example, nodes with consumer class GPUs. So these are workstation CPUs paired with consumer class GPUs. Energy efficiency might be a concern. So if you have to pay the energy yourself, then typically over the typical cluster lifetime of maybe 5 years or so, the cost for the energy are more or less the same as the cost for the hardware. So here we see nodes with zero up to four GPUs, and for a 5 year operation, we assumed 20 euro cents per kilowatt hour, including cooling, and we see that about half of the total costs come from the energy. And again, here it's the trajectories are cheapest if we have one or two GPUs in the node, and the trajectories are most expensive if we don't have any GPU in the node. This slide is a slightly different view of the same fact. So this is then we see the trajectory yield. So we see the nanoseconds per 1,000 euro that we get from these nodes. This is now with a bigger benchmark, with the ribosome benchmark. And so we see three categories, a blue, a green, and violet or so category. So the upper two compare the same CPU with 0, 1, 2, 3, or 4 GPUs, and the lower two compare the same GPU with two different CPUs. And again, what we see here, it's not good to plug in too many GPUs. So the optimum is about at one or two GPUs. There you get the highest trajectory yield per invested euro. So clearly balanced CPU and GPU resources are beneficial. Okay, that already brings me to the conclusions of question two. So generally, if you add a GPU to a node, this yields a up to four times increased node performance. Generally, consumer class GPUs increase the performance to price of a node more than twofold. These are the blue dots here in this right diagram. Usually, adding more GPUs than CPU sockets yields diminishing returns, and the highest energy efficiency is reached for nodes with balanced CPU and GPU resources. I'd like to point out that this whole investigation is summarized in this paper on the lower right here, best bang for your buck. So there's lots of more details and tweaks in that paper, and also in the supplements, together with scripts how you could do these benchmarks. And there's also a figure with GROMACS tweaks, performance tweaks for getting high performance. Okay, with that, you're in the question and answer session, and I'd like to thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Karsten. This was a really interesting talk with a lot of information and a lot of good tips for the users. As a general comment, you would recommend that users do initially some proper benchmarking before they start large production runs on whatever systems they have access to. As we've seen, users can save a huge amount of computer time, right?
Right. So, I mean, if you just run a single simulation of this type, maybe it doesn't matter to do benchmarking or not. You would just let GROMACS figure out the details. But if you run lots and lots of similar simulations, then it really pays off. So you can easily get 20, 30, 40% extra performance by tuning that, and then you will get a lot of trajectory back then for your project.
Yes, especially if your group has a very large allocation on a very large HPC system with millions of core hours, then you should definitely do some benchmarking beforehand.
Right. Usually you will have to do that already if you want to get the compute time, right? You should show that your code scales well, and there it really makes sense to put in the effort doing a few benchmarks, and maybe you get more compute time if you can show that you can scale well on the machine where you want to compute.
Yes. And this also holds, like what you presented here is a very big variety of mixtures of CPUs and GPUs. Now we have Xeon 5s coming to market, and more centers will offer them. So this will be another area for users to benchmark and see how the application performs.
That's true. Yeah, we didn't consider these up to now because they're quite expensive. So I think if you buy the hardware yourself, it's probably still the best bet to buy consumer class GPUs for a high node performance.
Yeah,
I mean, if you have a cluster there with Xeon 5s or so, then of course, yeah, why not use it?
We're nearing the. We actually have online another of the core developers who was working with Karsten Zillert, but if he wanted to add something. I guess we have some problems with the audio. So,
it's going to be working.
Yeah.
Hi.
Is there something you would like to add since you worked with Karsten on this extensive
I would like to thank Karsten first for the great talk, and I don't think I have a lot to add, except that I would like to note that although this work has been done with a few versions slightly older, most of the conclusions still apply up to the current versions. Things may change in the future because hardware is changing and the direction of our project is changing slightly, but a lot of the tips and the tricks and the general conclusions do apply. However, there have been quite a lot of performance improvements here and there. So, as always, it's worth upgrading and looking into using the performance of newer releases rather than trying to stick to old ones. That's one of the things that I would highly recommend users to exploit and to make use of the work that we do for every release. And last but not least, yes, as Karsten mentioned, AMD GPUs are also an option with our OpenCL implementation, and with the most recent release they are quite competitive both in price and performance. So it is worth considering, especially if you have around a decent AMD GPU, to try the performance of those.
Thank you, Zillert. We have a question by Adam. Adam, can you hear us?
Hi, yes, thank you. It's Adam Carter here at EPCC. I was just going to ask, I think most of the results that you presented here were for InfiniBand network, is that correct? And I just wondered whether you think any of the results would change qualitatively very much in the case of either slower networks like Ethernet or faster ones if there were some specific supercomputer interconnect.
It depends on what you want to do. So usually if you just want to sample a lot and you don't have excessively large systems, and you want to buy the hardware yourself, it's good to not even invest in InfiniBand, because this is quite this can cost you quite a bit, and it's always more efficient if you run more simulations on just single nodes, and the single node performance has gone so amazingly high the last years due to GPU acceleration, for example, that it's often possible to do that. However, if you really need, let's say, one big trajectory of a big system, and you need definitely need many nodes for a computation, then for scaling, for extreme scaling, it's always good to have the best network that you can get. That more or less depends on the network. And however, this comes at an extremely increased price of the trajectories. So typically this can go up to a factor of 10 or so, which you pay more for your trajectory if you run that near the scaling limit, or just if you scale it out to many nodes, as compared to running it on a single node. So what changes with slower or faster network is mainly where the scaling curve reaches the saturation, right? If you have InfiniBand and you can go up to, let's say, 16 or 32 nodes with your system, and then you go to slower and higher latency Ethernet, then typically you can go only to 4 or 8 nodes or so. But the I think the general picture remains the same. I'm not sure whether today you're really wasting cycles if you run on Ethernet, unless it's 10 gigabit Ethernet or so.
Okay, that's useful. Thanks very much. Yeah. Yes, thank you. Yeah.
So I would always compare the performance on one node to 2 or 4 or 8 nodes over Ethernet, and then you can really decide how much you're throwing away by going to, let's say, 4 or 8 nodes via Ethernet. Usually that will be quite a bit.
Great, thanks.
Thank you. Well, with this we are nearing the end of the webinar. Can we have the next slide? I'd like to remind everyone that a recording of today's webinar we put on the website, where you can watch it again and reference a lot of the useful tips and tricks that Carsten shared. We have at ask.bioexcel.eu, we have support forums and an interest group specifically on performance tuning, which you are welcome to use, and continue discussion there. And for those of you, I'd like to also announce that we will have in October a hackathon in Barcelona. If some of you are developing GROMACS and would like to meet some of the code developers and do some work on your code, please join us. You can find information for this on our website. So thank you all for today, and we will continue our webinar series in future. Check our website for updates on that. Thanks, Carsten. Thanks, Zillert. And we'll see you again. Bye.
Thank you. See you. Bye.
Thanks. Bye.